come forward.
Come up here to the stage. Come on, come on. Yeah, we belong at home. Can you sit down here just like last time? Good morning. Yeah, we belong. Levi is here. Praise the Lord. Hi, Caden. Yeah, there's so many new faces here today. I'm so glad to see all of you. I love you too, Benny. All right, how are you guys doing? Good. Does anybody know what holiday is coming up? There's a really special holiday. Which one is it, Livy?
Easter.
It's Easter. It's Easter. Easter's coming up. Now, right now, we're in the Lent season. And who knows what Lent is? Does anybody know? It's not something you find in your belly button. What is it?
You can't see.
Oh, no, not that.
You can't eat.
Oh, you can't eat. Somebody celebrating Lent at your house? No meat? No? So, you, okay.
I love cheeseburger.
He loves cheeseburger. Me too. So Lent is a season that leads us to the cross. That's what Lent is. It's a time where we think about our humanness. We're all humans, aren't we? Do we make mistakes? We definitely do. And sometimes our lives are messy, and sometimes we do bad things. But luckily, sometimes we do spill our milk and then we cry about it, you know? Yeah? But luckily, we don't have to stay in that ugly life, do we? Why not, Levi? Why do we not have to stay broken? What happened?
Jesus died on the cross.
That's exactly right. And that's what Lent is. It's the journey to the cross. And sometimes we give things up for Lent to join in Jesus in his suffering, right? Because Jesus suffered on the way to the cross. It wasn't an easy journey, was it? So I have right here Lent in a bag, okay? And I'm going to let you guys pick some things out, and then we're going to talk about why or how this helps us to think about Lent in a new way, okay? All right, so what's your name, honey, with the stars on your dress?
Allison.
Allison, can you come up here real quick? And I would like you to pull something out of that bag, okay? Can you pull something out of there? Ooh, I was hoping you'd pull that one first. Can I see it? Thank you. What is this? Look real close. What's in here? It's dirt. Yeah, it's a special kind of dirt. It's sand. It's sand. Cookie sand. Well, not exactly, but sand. Okay. And where do we find sand? On the world, in the world, where do we find sand? On the beach. Yeah, I thought you might say that, Oaks boys. Where else?
On the ground.
It's somewhere where it's very hot and dry. In where, Livy?
The desert.
In the desert. Okay, sit down. I'm going to tell you about the desert. So before Jesus started his ministry, he spent some time in the desert, okay? And what's it like in a desert?
Hot.
It's hot, very hot. How do you think he felt? Is there a lot of water in the desert? No, so he was thirsty, right? It was a hard time for Jesus. And the reason I put sand in here is because I wanted you to think about your own lives. Are we going to go through hard things, kids? Yeah, we will. Maybe not until you're like seven or eight. But there's going to be some hard things, or nine. There's going to be some hard things in our lives. Now, are we alone when there's hard things in our lives? Are we alone? We're not. Jesus promises to be there with us. We also have our mommy and our daddy, and they point us to Jesus, don't they? So that's why I put sand in here, because I wanted you to think about your life. There's going to be times, like Jesus, where you go through desert seasons, right, Riley? Yeah. And you're going to have to remember that God's here with me, even in the desert, okay? All right, I have another one. Jace, can you stick your arm in there and pull one out? Ooh, I love this one. Jace, what do you think that is?
I don't know.
I can tell you. Can I see it? Let's hold it up for the grown-ups to see. What is this? Anybody? What do you think?
A whale.
A whale. You have a very good imagination. This is a hyacinth bulb. And a hyacinth is a very beautiful flower, and they smell so nice. And this actually should be in the ground right now because it would be coming up around Easter time. But I want to tell you something about bulbs. This bulb has to start decaying. That means it kind of has to get yucky, and it has to start kind of dying before these little you don't eat it. No, that'd be yucky. but it has to die before a beautiful flower can come out of it. Who else do we know that died? You can hold it. Mm-hmm. Who died? Who died on a cross?
Jesus.
Jesus did, right? But did he stay dead? No. Just like this beautiful bulb, it doesn't stay dead. Jesus rose from the grave, right? And he offered us eternal life. Just like this bulb will someday spring a flower right up, right? But then this flower will die again. But will Jesus ever die? No, he's always alive. He's in our hearts, right? He's in heaven, seated next to the Father. And he helps us to manage our lives and to live more like him, okay? All right, can I have that, Riley? Thank you, dear. Okay, I have another one. Eason, you gonna pull something out of there? Ooh, I love this one too. What is that? Oh, it's not a crystal. It's a big rock, right? Or a little rock. It's a stone. Okay, so you can look at it, maybe pass it around. While Jesus was in the desert, he was tempted by the devil, and you'll get to see it. Hold on. He was tempted by the devil. The devil, I need you to be quiet. The devil showed him some stones, and he said, "Why don't you turn these stones into bread, and so you won't be so hungry?" And Jesus said, "No. No, I have everything I need with God," right? So can I see that stone real quick, please? But Jesus, okay, so Jesus didn't turn the loaves of bread, or the stone into loaves of bread, but he does do something amazing with our hearts. So before we know Jesus, our hearts are kind of like this. They're kind of stony, right? They're hard. And Jesus helps to transform our hearts, right? Once Jesus gets a hold of it, our hearts, he turns it into something that's loving and compassionate and more like him. So even though he didn't turn the stone to loaves of bread, he does change our stony hearts. And that's pretty wonderful, isn't it? You want to say something? Okay. Caden, pull. Don't pull a candle. Pull that one thing. That one. What is that, Caden? What is it? Can I see it, please? Thank you. What is this? It is an ice cream spoon, but it has a little face on it, doesn't it? It's a smiley face. This little piece of wood helps us to remember that we're human, right? But who else became human and came down? You can't eat it. No, sorry. Don't eat this one either. So Jesus became human like us, and he came to earth, and he experienced all of those scary things that we go through. He knows what it's like to lose someone that you love. He knows what it's like to be tempted with sin, right? He knows all of those things, and he's provided us a way to rise above those things and to be like him. So this little wooden figure helps us to remember that we're human, right? We fall short of God's glory, but Jesus became human so that we could be with God, right?
Yeah.
That's pretty fantastic, isn't it, Lincoln?
I have Jesus.
Oh, awesome. All right, Jensen, pull out that last thing. What is this? It is a candle. All right, I need you to sit down. It's going to get dangerous. All right. Riley, scoot back a little bit, honey.
Don't eat it, Riley.
Yeah, can't eat this one either. Oh, I should have practiced this. Okay, don't touch it because it's hot. If it was dark in here, would this candle give us some light?
Yeah.
It would. The Bible says that Jesus is the light of the world. And then Jesus said a funny thing. He turned around and he said that we are the light of the world, that we are a city on a hill. Should we put this fire under a bushel? Should we cover it up with a basket? No, we shouldn't. We should be so proud of the light that Jesus has put inside of us, and we should tell everyone we know about how much Jesus loves us. We do, and we're going to take a minute to blow this out. But the thing that I want you guys to hear right now is you, little kids at Watonga Church of the Nazarene, you are the light of the world. Don't blow it yet, Bennett. What can we do? No, we don't eat it. What can we do to be the light of the world? What's something we could do? Anybody have an idea? What do you think?
We can help people.
We can help others. Very good. What else? What if they're hungry? Should we give them a snake?
We can give them some food.
We can give them some food. What if they're sad? What could we do, Jace?
Get some water.
Give them water. I like that. We could give hugs, couldn't we, Riley? We can show them Jesus' love, can't we? And that's how we can be the light, okay? All right, I'm going to hold it out. And on when I say three, everybody blow, okay? One, two, three. Oh, good job. All right. So now do you remember, are you going to be able to remember what Lent is about? Not in a dryer, right? Well, it is, but not this kind of Lent, okay? All right, you can go sit back down. I'm so glad you were here this morning.
It kind of sounds like that the Hoyles need to feed the grandchildren a little bit more. More hot dogs. Okay. Well, we had kids up here. Now we're going to bring more kids up here. All right. Yeah. So Dusty and Tiffany, come on up here. Yeah. What's up, Alan? You want to come to me? No, you? Okay. Daddy, okay. Hey, whenever we dedicate children, what we want to communicate clearly is this is a representation, this is a partnership, this is a covenant in which that they are entering in, first of all, between the parents and God. First of all, is that they're saying to God, we believe in you. We know that your love is unconditional for us. And so we know wholeheartedly that it is our responsibility between you and I to come alongside of the children, the disciples in which that you gave us, that this is our responsibility, first and foremost. And so, God, we need your help. It seems like a daunting task, especially if for some of you that have raised children, you say it is a daunting task because children are unpredictable. We cannot force them certain ways to behave. We can't force beliefs upon them. But God, through your Holy Spirit, we ask for illumination. We ask for those seeds to be planted. And so what we say is that as far as it depends upon us, we want to direct their feet to the paths of the sanctuary and their little minds to Scripture. And so they're doing their part on their end. And what they also say between them and God, what they're wanting also to do is extend this out to you. That this is a covenant relationship between the Langfords and the church here. To say that we want partnership, we need help. and I hear their cry because we all need help. But what we're saying is that we give you permission. We give you permission to come alongside of us. And we're asking you and we're begging you, would you do that? Would you come alongside of them? And so they're going to present their children to the church. And I'm asking you again, I know we've been up and down, but maybe it's going to keep you awake this morning. Would you stand to your feet? And we're going to present Lincoln Michael first. Could you come to me, buddy? Can I pray with you?
Go to Kaysen.
Okay, why don't you just stand right there? Is that okay? Okay, I'm going to pray with you, Lincoln, okay? Lincoln, do you know Jesus?
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of that name before?
Yeah.
Yeah? What do you know about Jesus?
There's the game.
There's the game Jesus? I've never played that one.
Yeah. It's the Bible game.
Oh, the Babel game. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Bible app? Yeah, the Bible one. Is Jesus a pretty cool guy?
Yeah.
Do you love him?
He also takes evil spirits away.
Evil spirits away, okay. What about, does he love you? Does Jesus love you? Do you know that? Okay, well, that's great. Let's pray for Lincoln. Lincoln, we give this name to you. We give this child to you. We give his heart and his soul, and I pray that his mind continues to be directed towards your word. And let him know without a doubt that your mind is already made up about him. Before the dawn of creation, that you have made your mind up about Lincoln, and it's great good news. You love him. But Lord, we ask for your spirit to abide upon Dusty and Tiffany, to come alongside of Lincoln and direct his thoughts to the thoughts and the mind of Christ, and his feet to your sanctuary. And that when one day, whenever he's old, and he can say with his own hands that he is going to find a vocation that is going to be pleasing to you, and that he would give his entire life and energy to you. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. And then there's Alan Ebner. Is that right, Alan?
Yeah.
Alan. Do you know Jesus? Have you ever heard that name? No? I'm setting you up because I know that you know Jesus, right? And you know that he loves you?
Yeah.
Yeah? We'll just say that you're saying yeah. Hey, how about this? And this is the testing here. Does your daddy love you?
No, Papa.
Bubba loves you.
Me.
Okay. Grandma, yeah. Okay.
And I play video games sometimes.
Okay. See, I know he's just going to say no to anything that I say right now. So.
Yeah.
So, Alan. Alan, can I pray with you?
No.
Okay, that's what I thought. But I'm going to do it anyway, okay? Lord, I thank you for a gift of Alan, this precious treasure that you have given this family, and also the responsibility of raising a child by the name of Alan that says no sometimes.
Yeah.
But Lord, we ask that you direct his steps. And I pray that you direct Dusty and Tiffany's steps in directing Alan's steps. I pray that you bless him. I pray that you save his mind, and that you give him wisdom, that you give them wisdom, Lord, and that his feet will be directed to your sanctuary. And at an old age that he would know, or at a young age that he would know you, and even in his older years that he would choose a vocation that is pleasing to you, and that he would work with his hands and your spirit guiding his hands. And we give these children to you, and it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Congregation, would you stretch out your hands to them? And would you pray this prayer alongside of me? And would you repeat this after me? With God's help, we covenant with you to come alongside of you. For God's sake and these souls' sake. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Give them a round of applause. You may be seated. Now is the time of the service in which that I just wish that I'm going to be in fast forward mode here, because we still got some elements that I want to get to that I'm very excited about, okay? And I really wish that we have like this theme song in which now the kids stay in the pews and all the adults come and gather around here, okay? So, whoa, and all the kids come, or all the adults come up and sit down here. There's a couple of things that I want you to be aware of before we dive into God's word, okay? One of the things that I want you to be aware of is that this Wednesday night, we are having family worship night, which teens have some activities, the children have some activities. We're going to sing some songs together, and it's a great night for everybody to come and join. And it starts at 5:30, and we try to end around 7 or 7:30. So this Wednesday night. But I want you also to be aware of what happened last Wednesday night. It's funny, Laura came to me and she kind of came up to beside me and she says, "We have a youth group." We had record-setting attendance, it seemed like, in Weebies. We had maxed out four different groups, and on Wednesday nights, we had four different groups, and all those four different groups, their sponsors were like, we can't take on another one. And so we had that going on, and we had about 12 teenagers, roughly, about last Wednesday. So great things happened on Wednesday night. And one last thing, Thursday. This upcoming Thursday is a milestone in O'Keene, Oklahoma. It's our second birthday of having services in O'Keene. Second birthday, yeah. I don't know what's up with these shoes. But with that in mind, I am imploring to you, put it down in your calendar. Come join us 6:45 O'Keene, because I have got a big announcement. I mean, life-changing announcement. And I'm not going to share it with you. I want to share it with you, with them. Okay? So you'll hear it next Sunday if you don't come. But we want to pack the house because it's going to be a great celebration. It's a milestone. And it's interesting how dates like that happen, line up bit by bit, right? If you have your Bibles with me. And I don't know why I said with me, because I left my Bible, I think, somewhere in Sunday school. Where did I leave my Bible? I was teaching with it somewhere. Did I leave it back there in the back, Carrie? Is it that green one? I'm going to ask for help, like Tiffany and Dusty did. I'm your pastor, but I don't know where my Bible went. Well, I'm going to ask somebody else to read. That's what I'll do. Would you turn to 1 Samuel? 1 Samuel chapter 16. And I'm just going to see if anybody's reading along with me or following along with me. 1 Samuel, chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. 1 through 13. We got a volunteer to read? It's like Sunday school. No? If nobody volunteers, I'm going to call upon you. Thank you, Tiffany. Go for it. 1 Samuel, chapter 16, 1 through 13. Hear the word of the Lord.
And Jehovah said unto Saul, "How long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from being king over Israel? Fill thy horn with oil and go. I will send thee to Jesse, the best of the might, for I have provided me a king among his sons." And Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me." And Jehovah said, I'm going to change my version real quick. "How can I do that?" Samuel asked. "When Saul hears of it, he'll kill me. Take a heifer with you," the Lord replied, "and say, I have come to make a sacrifice to the Lord. Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will make clear to you what you should do. You will anoint for me the person I point out to you." Samuel did what the Lord instructed. When he came to Bethlehem, the city elders came to meet him. They were shaking with fear. "Do come in peace," they said. "Yes," Samuel answered, "I've come to make a sacrifice to the Lord. Now make yourselves holy, then come with me to the sacrifice." Samuel made Jesse and his sons holy and invited them to the sacrifice as well. When they invited, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought, "That must be the Lord's anointed right in front of you." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Have no regard for his appearance or stature, because I haven't selected him. God doesn't look at things like humans do. Humans see only what is visible to the eyes, but the Lord sees into the heart." Next, Jesse called for
Abinadab,
who presented himself to Samuel, but he said, "The Lord hasn't chosen this one either." So Jesse presented Shema, but Samuel said, "No, the Lord hasn't chosen this one." Jesse presented seven to the sons of Samuel, but Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord hasn't picked any of these." Then Samuel asked Jesse, "If of all of your boys, there is still the youngest one?" Jesse answered, "But he's out keeping the sheep. Send for him," Samuel told Jesse, "because we can't proceed until he gets here." So Jesse sat and brought him in. He was reddish brown, had beautiful eyes, and was good looking. The Lord said, "That's the one, go anoint him." So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him right there in front of his brothers. The Lord's spirit came over David from that point forward. Then Samuel left and went to Jerusalem.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Tiffany, for that. And then I got to follow along with you, too. Thank you, Frankie, for finding my Bible for me. And I don't know if you know this, but I did print out a children's bulletin. Did everybody, who didn't get a children's bulletin that wants one or needs one? Some of it is age appropriate for some of you. Some of it is pretty difficult. I couldn't find a lot of the words in the word search myself. We're in Sunday in Lent. We're right in the middle of it. We got a few more Sundays before Easter arrives. And today, obviously, because of the screen and because of your bulletins, we're talking a little bit about blindness. And I really, really like this video. And so just for time's sake, we're just going to hop right into the video. I really liked what happened this late night show here.
What? I'm just saying, are you sure you're okay to drive? Because this is making me feel a bit uneasy.
My hands are on.
Stevie Wonder takes on James Corden's Carpool Karaoke. After jokingly sitting behind the wheel, Stevie jumped over to the passenger seat for a jam sesh to his own hits, including this sweet phone call to James's wife.
I just gone to say James loves you. I just want to say how much he cares. I just want to say he loves you. And he promises to me that he'll let me be on his show for an hour.
Yes, Stevie brought James to tears.
You've just won so many brownie points with my wife.
I don't know how safe that he was if Stevie happens to drive the vehicle, but love some of his music, and I don't get to watch late night TV. Because by 9:30 at night, I'm hoping to get ahead of a waking baby sometime in between there. This is kind of what we're talking about, is that we're talking about a particular blindness. And there was a remaking of an old game show called the Tell the Truth. And this is really the type of blindness that we're talking about. It seems like that there's a wall there, and there's one person that is trying to kind of figure out who of these characters is like the doctor, or is like the shepherd, or whoever that it might be. And they have to ask questions, and two of them are actors, and one is the real deal. And so they're asking questions, they're trying to figure out who this particular person is, and it seems like that there is a list, like this mess that happens. All three of these characters are trying to convince the person asking the question whether or not that they are this particular person. And so a lot of times the person that is asking the question, they're trying to figure out, does this person look like that he's a doctor? Does he look like that he could see? Does he look like that he could act? You know, does it look like that he has spent any time in the military? Does this person look like that he's homeless? There are certain things that vocationally that maybe that you can look at a person, you can shape them up, measure them up, and say, oh, they look like that they could fill that role pretty well. You know, maybe this passage of scripture is for you. Maybe this particular story is for you, because whenever I look at this characteristic about how this prophet, this judge of Israel by the name of Samuel, goes and tries to find the anointed one. This whole Lent season is, we've been talking about like drawing ugly crosses and stuff like that. I can tell you that whenever I watch the movie The Passion of the Christ, there's a lot of times that I wanted to turn my eyes away from it. I wanted to turn a blind eye to the gore, because it seemed like that not only was Jesus getting beat up and beaten to a pulp, but that's my Savior, and I feel like that I'm the one getting beat up as well. And so I don't like my Jesus looking all beat up. I want him. I used to have this T-shirt in high school. I ended up wearing it to a lot of basketball practices and stuff like that, and I got it all gross, and so I had to cut the sleeves off of it. But it's this picture of Jesus, and he is ripped, and he is bench pressing a cross. And I mean, he's just ripped to shreds, and that's the Jesus that I like. And on the top of it, it said, Lord's Gym. You know, he bench presses crosses. That's the kind of Jesus that I like. I don't like this meek lamb, the one that would, like a sheep dumb to its slaughter, willingly and humbly be led away to his slaughter. I don't like that image of Jesus. We've been talking about the Protestants, clean, you know, straight cross without Jesus being on it. And I appreciate that. I appreciate that that image, because we believe that we live under the shadow of an empty cross. And that informs our decisions, because Jesus is not on the cross anymore. He's alive and well. And we live in that day. We live it today as Resurrection Sunday, every day. But there's also the thought in which the Catholicism, the Catholics believe, that putting Jesus upon the cross, on this crucifix, it reminds everybody that maybe, just maybe, and I appreciate this, and we've been talking a little bit about this, is that maybe, just maybe, this Jesus on the cross, if it's in front of you and reminding you each and every day that it's there on the cross, then maybe, just maybe, it reminds you your involvement in putting Jesus upon the cross. It's a reminder that you and I are not too far removed from being involved in nailing Jesus' hands upon the cross and feet. We were the ones in the audience saying, crucify him. We were the ones in the audience. And so we've been pulling out these certain characters. The first character was Judas. And we recognize that certain things in his mentality that maybe we are not just too far removed from. And then we looked at a guy named Caiaphas. I keep on saying that wrong. Caiaphas? Caiaphas. And that maybe we're not too far removed from a person like him. And today, we're talking about Pontius Pilate. This guy that would say, he would measure up someone like Jesus, and he would stand back, and he would look at him, and he is all beaten to a pulp. He's bloody, and he's coming before his accusers. And Pilate's looking at the audience and like, is this a king? As far as authority goes, that the authority that is placed upon Pontius Pilate, there is this thing called the Pax Romana, in which that the Roman people would look upon that particular treaty and say, look at us, there is a moment of peace. And really what that was all about is that if you disagreed with Rome, then Rome was going to come with an army. And Rome was going to come heavy, and so basically, if you had anything against Rome, we would shut you up with a sword and arrows and all those other types of things. That's the way that peace looked like for Rome. This is the type of authority that we were going to flex. This is the type of, and so Pontius Pilate will look at Jesus and say, this guy is your king? As far as authority is concerned, as far as the way that it looks like as a king, Jesus doesn't look the part. And so gladly, although that he wrestled with that, we've seen this in whenever he would say, I give you Barabbas or Jesus, and the crowd would even say, give us Barabbas. Pontius Pilate didn't really think that there was much of a threat in this guy, because as far as authoritative figures go, he didn't look the part. He looked meek, he looked bloody, he looked weak as far as authority goes. And so that's the reason why that I would get to this particular passage whenever we look at Samuel. Samuel was this anointed, appointed man of God who would go and he would be the judge of the land. And we read this passage of scripture in 1 Samuel chapter 16, not far off of the heels of the people of Israel rejecting Christ's judge, or God's judge in Samuel. So what they would say was that they would say, you know, all these other nations, they got this thing called kingdoms. They've got these kings, and it seems like that's the way of the world right now. And so they went to Samuel, and they said, Samuel, you know, you've been good, but not good enough. Can you imagine hearing that? God's man, and somebody says, you know, you've been good, but, you know, what have you done for us lately? We don't look like any of the other thriving countries. And you know what the difference is that we don't have a king. And so Samuel goes to God and says, you know, these people are crying out for a king. What do you say? What sayeth you? And God says, I don't think you want to go with that direction. Absolutely not. You know, taxes, you know, military campaigns, this hierarchy, that's not in my will. So Samuel goes back and says, you know what? God says no. You know what they say to Samuel? Go back to God and tell him this is what we want. We want a king. And so God says, give them what they want. Go anoint a king. Because you want to know what is out there? You want to know what's out there? Giants. We need somebody to lead us just in case that those giants come to us. Because, I mean, it's not like that we haven't seen in the past that God fights battles for us, right? God fights for God's people. But it seems as if that how did we foresee something that possibly happened? We know that there's giants out there. And so what Samuel does is he goes and anoints this king. What was the first king's name? Just see if you're out there. Saul. You want to know how Samuel kind of said, oh, this is a good guy, because you want to know, he was a head taller than everybody else. He was a tall guy. And you know how to fight giants? With giants. And so they got this tall king. But then it seems like that God's presence was taken away from Saul. It seemed like that God said, I reject you as king, and I'm going to go find somebody else. And what ends up happening in the chapter that Tiffany read was that Samuel goes to Jesse, and he says, this is where God sent me. Present me your boys. And so the first guy, Eliab, come up, and he's like, ooh, this is a nice specimen. He's tall, he's dark, he's handsome. This looks like a guy that we can anoint as king. And I tell you what, there's a little bit of insecurity that happens with me, Sam, right? Whenever we start talking about height, yeah? Is that whenever he said, I'm at least 6 foot, okay? So whenever I'm saying, okay, maybe I'm God's man, because the way that Saul was anointed, and then they looked at Eliab and they said, okay, it looks like it. And he says, do not look upon the appearance. Don't judge based upon the appearance. And so they go through all the sons. But here's the thing. Whenever David starts coming in, here's a little bit of hope, okay? A little bit of hope for us that are a little bit taller than others. Is that David had really good blue eyes. There you go. He didn't say blue eyes, but something about his eyes made him look handsome. And he was tall in stature. But you want to know what? That the outward thing was not what made David ready for the job. It was what God was preparing for him on the inside is what made him ready. You know, Samuel was somebody that maybe we're not too far removed from. Maybe as far as that is concerned, we tend to look at outward appearances and say, that guy's got it together, so he must be God's man. Or that woman seems like that she's got it all together. Maybe that she is God's woman. I want you to, you know, maybe you're not very excited about this particular part of it, but what we've got to acknowledge is that somehow, some way, that maybe our culture has influenced our culture, and that there's important definitions that we need to listen to. But at some point, if you don't distance yourself from the training offered up by the culture, you will not be able to make sense of what God is saying. If you do not distance yourself from what the culture is saying, you are not going to be able to test and discern what God is saying. Now, here's something that we end up doing. Whenever we look at the outward appearance of somebody, Sam, I know you're back. Can you come up here? And I'm not, we're not talking about height now, okay? Say for instance that that cross is our destination. Let's turn our backs to the audience so they don't see us, and we'll get all of our good sides right here. This is where we want to be. And it seems as if that whenever we look at the outward appearance, and I look at Sam and I was like, well, maybe I want to be a little bit more like Sam, and so maybe I start being more like Sam. But I haven't gotten any closer to where I need to be as far as Christ is concerned. And there's the other aspect of it, Sam, is that maybe that you look at me and you're just like, well, at least I'm not him. And we start distancing ourselves from each other. And we still haven't gotten any closer to where we want to be, right? Thank you, Sam. Give him a round of applause. It took a lot of courage, Sam. It took a lot of courage. There's a sense of comparison even in our culture whenever we don't distance ourselves from those particular things that inform our decision. We don't get any closer to where God wants us to be because we are comparing each other, and we're either getting ourselves closer to one another or further apart. Do we never take steps closer to where we need to be. So, Christianity happens to be better whenever we see the glory of God together. And being united with Christ is the only way that we can experience this million-dollar word or two-cent word, however that you say it, sanctification. We're never going to be Christ-like outside of being unified in the body of Christ. So sometimes whenever we start comparing each other and we start dogging on each other and say, I cannot believe that I can go to church with those people, is whenever we're really, really in danger and we would really start questioning whether that we're sanctified or not. Okay, let me hear you say it. Because God's will is to be unified in Christ, in the body of Christ. Now what that doesn't mean, that does not mean that you cannot have a difference of opinion. What it means is that you can sit in the same room, that you can be together, that you can be unified and still have a difference of opinion. Okay, real quick, how many here are Democrats? No, don't say, raise your hand. How many of you are Republicans? I'm not telling you to raise your hand. How many of you are pacifists? How many of you are ready to hand in your guns? How many of you are ready to hold on to your guns? How many of you have difference of opinion whenever it comes to that? You want to know the miracle of being united in Christ is that because that you have a different mindset, because you have a difference of opinion, you can still set and believe and be unified in the mind of Christ. That's what a sanctified believer is about. It's not outside of having the same opinions or have the same mindsets of everybody else. In fact, the whole comparison should be outside the window. The whole idea of being one with Christ, being one in unity, should always be about Christ and Christ alone. Now, if you have a difference of opinion about these types of things and you're sitting in the same room, I tell you what, you're in good company. You can have a difference of opinion. But if you are sitting here today, let me just kind of wrap up shop. And Olivia, if you would like to go up and get ready, you can. If you were dearly, dearly disappointed in last year's election, or if you were dearly, dearly satisfied with all that and thinking that God was very happy in the outcome or very sad in the outcome, are you thinking that maybe, just maybe, that he had some type of purpose that he's going to work through our vote and our vote alone? I think either way, either you're happy or you're dissatisfied with the outcome, you're overly dissatisfied in the way that God is going to operate. Because God does not operate through political systems. Because what God operates is through the body of Christ. Christ is the head of the body. I have never, ever have heard in Scripture where Christ is the head of the United States of America. He's not a nationalist. He's a bodyist. He is about the body, and how he brings about his redemptive work is the body of believers. And if you hear me this morning and you think all this is all about body, you better start getting healthier. Then you're right. It's not about the comparison game, because if you're comparing to somebody else, you're comparing your right thumb to your left thumb. Because we're in it together. It's not about shaping up. It's about what's inside. It's about Christ. I love this image that you're about to find through Olivia. I sat and I interviewed her just a little bit ago before service. And I asked her, I said, you know, because I think that whenever we baptize somebody at the age of 6, about to be 7, we get to be a little bit skeptical. Like, do you know what she's getting into? Do you know the ramifications of this? And what I told Tiffany, I said, I think you're going to be surprised. Because I was surprised. Because I can't reiterate exactly what she said, but in a sense, how she summarized it, I said, what does baptism mean to you? And in my words, what she had said, my life is not mine from here on out. My decisions from here on out is about Christ. And that's the baptism water speaking. That's the miracle of the baptism water. The baptism water is the person that's going in, knowing, going into it, that old person is gone, and a new one's coming up. Now, I don't think that there's a laundry list of sins that we can say that is going to be washed away from Olivia's life. But there is a nature that she's expecting to be different about her. There's this old saying of, or old school thought in their mind, I always want what I want. And in transitioning from going down to coming up, I want what Jesus wants. That's a representation of this baptism. Robin, I know that you're not, but you're here. Could I use you? Would you mind playing some on the piano? We're gonna be really quick. Next time you'll see me, we'll be coming up here, okay? Thank you. So here we are, and we're going to present to you Olivia Landreth. Can you see up here? Olivia, is there something that you want to say about Jesus and what he means to you?
He means to me that he'll always love me wherever I go.
Amen. Amen. And isn't that enough? Isn't that enough to know? Olivia, what's your middle name?
Rochelle.
Rochelle. Olivia, we're going to face this way. What you're going to do is you're going to plug your nose like that, and what you're going to hold onto your wrist. Okay. Olivia Rochelle Landreth, upon your confession that Jesus Christ is Lord, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your gracious work, your provisions that you've made upon our lives. I pray that we would be reminded today of our own baptism and the covenant that has first been extended to us, that you love us first. I pray that we live that out, and that this reminds us of that time in which that maybe, just maybe, that our lives were so radically changed that it informed our decisions, that it informed our lives. Thank you for your indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And I pray that you go with us in the mighty and the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. If you guys would like to wait and greet Olivia as she gets changed, but otherwise tell a few people that you're glad they're in church.